to get into the kingdom of heaven, right, blah, blah, blah. This really is, you know, it's a theory of child's play, right?
Yeah.
The theory of creation is like children playing. I mean, not like the half-aware children that we have on this earth, right? But, you know, God as a child or consciousness as this playful being, seeking to have fun and to maintain joy and to do all these other things. And as kind of a rubric for understanding the physical world and our purpose and everything else, I think it's far superior to anything else out there, because everything else out there makes us into, you know, some kind of a broken, ejected from the garden, dark soul, original sin, violent from a primitive past, evolved. It's, you know, the images that we have of our origin and our purpose right now are ugly images, and I don't care who's saying that. They are all ugly at some level, but this one says no. You know, and it seems not only is it explaining the physical world, or it's offering a possible explanation, but it's taking all this other dogma and turning that on its head too, and saying, you know, enough of that. You know, no wonder our world. Sorry, I'm waxing philosophic here. That's not in the article for those of you. Oh my God, is he saying these things in the article? Not, but you know, it's turning all this stuff on its head and saying, enough of this. You know, if one of the stronger implications of this is, if consciousness is the root of all things, then the reason why our world is the way it is because of these dumb ideas that we have in consciousness. So, you know, here's a new one. Here's a new vision and a new image, a new theory, however you want to talk about it, that replaces those things and allows us to transform, that will allow us to transform the world, and I don't think it's going to take very long, in the years ahead.
Mm.
Right? It's something that's I think it's quite revolutionary in the way it presents things. And it's not new. You know, a lot of people have said this down the ages, but I think, you know, the language has been corrupted, or it's been poor translations, or as happened with the Catholic Bible, the church has actually gone in and edited the document, right?
Yeah.
Its own stuff. So there's a lot of corruption. So it's not new, but it is kind of a representation of something that has been known in esoteric doctrine for a long time.
Yeah, and it has to, I think it has to be, you know, retold. You know, for, as you say, it's if new, you know, new generations comes along and new things has to be explained in a new way, and I guess we even can tie that back to the, you know, what Jesus talked about. We're in the era of you know, around Jesus, that we're talking about the fact that, you know, we needed someone for even the scriptures to come alive, to use a new language, and, you know, all of that stuff. So it definitely is something that needs to be repeated in a new way and in a, you know, new fashion and using new words and for people in this time to be able to understand it, because as you say, they you know, what I kind of not was worried about, but you know, as we were beginning talking, you know, if you can, is it possible to you know, reach through and penetrate and get through to the scientific community? And one of the things that I came to think about is that it's not that this information isn't out there and hasn't been out there. I mean, as you say, people like Sheldrake and a lot of others have been going on at this for a long time, and a lot of people have been doing great work, and there's incredible information out there on these topics and on these theories. But the question is yet, you know, okay, so do we see any change from that? Do we see that the scientific community are adjusting to that? Or again, do you think that this is because you mentioned that I guess you think in the years ahead that things actually will change a lot, I guess, and I guess I could return to the first question, you know, do you think that this could be connected in some way, in, for instance, with you know, we have experiments, for instance, now with the super colliders or particle accelerators that actually are recreating the Big Bang, and we can see, you know, multiple dimensions and stuff like this. I'm going on and on here, but do you think that kind of science is something that would help to propel this along? Do you think that?
Well, I'm not a physicist, so I don't know about that. I mean, I don't really believe that when they're using those particle accelerators, they're not really recreating the conditions of the Big Bang. They're just, you know, creating kind of a shadow conditions of it. It's not really consciousness entering into matter. But I do think that what will happen will be that people will think about this. Like, for example, and I use some examples of this in the article, for example, psychologists, surprisingly enough, have not considered boredom an interesting topic since its inception. It's been a taboo topic. Nobody's looked at it. It's only now is that starting to happen.
Yeah.
But you know, after reading this article, maybe a psychologist who's looking around for something to study will look at boredom, and this might trigger, you know, a new perspective on consciousness. I mean, I'm thinking if I was a psychologist, I'd be interested in the fundamental characteristics of consciousness, or you know, because I would consider boredom one of the first emergent properties of consciousness.
Yeah.
Very important, right? And I know from my own life that boredom is something I'm always fighting. And if I look at my kids, I know that, you know, if you sit them in a corner, they cannot sit down for more than about 15 seconds before they got to get to jump up and they go, right?
Yeah, exactly.
My thumb produced. So
yeah.
Considering how fundamental that appears to be, it's surprising that psychology hasn't looked at it. When it does, when somebody says, oh, wait, okay, and here's a deeper theory that can inform that interest in boredom, you know, who knows what they're going to come up with. I think that the field of psychology will explode and blossom in a way that is going to make a lot of the intractable problems that they have with mania and all this other stuff are going to become more understandable as they kind of expand into a wider perspective on consciousness that doesn't. Same thing with sociology. I'm a sociologist. I can see amazing implications for this in almost all topics that are covered by sociologists.
Yeah.
But it really requires another 50, 100 years of concerted work on the part of a lot of sociologists to kind of work out the implications of this. Same thing in biology. Same thing in technology. There's this guy by the name of Tiller who's done some really interesting stuff on technology and the ability to, he talks about in his papers conditioned spaces, and he says that, you know, some technologies, especially, you know, magical technologies, won't work in the real world. They'll work in a laboratory because the laboratory has been conditioned by the consciousness of the person doing the experiment. So it's like they create a little magical bubble where these technologies will in fact work, but then they go and take them out into the real world and that bubble is gone and they're out into the harsh underneath the harsh lights of the materialists, and the experiment doesn't work anymore
because
the actual rules of physics aren't operating the same as in the laboratory, right?
Yeah.
So once scientist picks up on that, you know, oh my God, and what does this happen? I have this meditation, the Great Invocation. You're probably aware of that, right?
Yeah.
You know? I looked at that when I read Herbert Tiller's stuff. I looked at that in a totally different way. I said, well, you know, this is a global conditioning.
Yeah.
is actually saying, do this meditation, and we'll condition the world to magic, is basically what it's saying. And so as people catch on to this, and people who aren't into the science, but just into the mystical side, and then they do that meditation or similar meditations, and the scientists are going to start to see the magic that people have talked about, like cold fusion, these things are going to start to become easier and easier to accomplish. So, I mean, I really am, when I talk about technological revolution, I really am seeing big, big technological revolutions of a type that there is no precedent for them, you know.
Yeah.
The article with the comment like that, like, it's going to make what we've done so far look like child's play.
Yeah.
That really makes sense.
And that's a positive outlook on all this. Hey, Michael, listen, I think it's time to wrap up this segment for now, but I would love to continue and talk a little more about the benefits, and you have some excellent stuff about as above and so below scale and stuff like this. But before we, you know, head into that, the next segment and talk about that, tell us when this book or booklet will available on your website and how people can get it when it's out.
Well, a draft of it is available now, and depending on when this is aired, it could be available to purchase by then. It'll be a small thing, but I mean, it's the actual PDF is going to be free on the website, so you know, feel free to download. The draft that's there right now is far off the final one. It's basically just copy editing now. So it's you know, on the website underneath the tab academics. At the top there's a bunch of tabs. There's an academics one, and if you click that, explanation and then a link to the actual book.
Excellent. And you have, I guess, you know, all your books and so forth are available through michaelsharp.org, right?
Sure. All my stuff is available through Amazon.
Amazon. Okay. Yeah. Excellent. Yeah. We're going to, you know, continue in the subscriber section, Michael, but we'll take a short break then and we'll be right back. We are going to continue our conversation with Michael Sharp now in our subscriber section, and we are going to dive deeper into some of the benefits of the theory we have been talking about, and about the connection between health and consciousness. We'll also get into talking about the ascension process, the transition period, the destruction of the old structures, and the timetable for it all. And we're also going to talk about how fear makes us hold on to the old structures. Very good stuff, so don't miss out. Join us in the subscriber section for the continuation of this interview. We also want to mention that if you're not a subscriber, this is an excellent time to take the opportunity to sign up with us. In the transition over to July, we are going to bump up the prices for our subscriptions, so this is a very good time to come aboard. If you're already subscribing, as a subscriber you will be able to renew your subscriptions for the same rates as before, so this is only for people who aren't part of Red Eyes Creations yet. So take this opportunity and take advantage of our 3 months or 6 month subscriptions that we have up there for you. You will find all the details in our radio section at our website redicecreations.com. Thanks to producer Fredrik Palmgren for handling the controls and the audio. We will be back on Thursday again with another program lined up for you. Until then, we'll talk more online. This is Henrik Palmgren. Thank you for tuning in.
Tell them.